Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Confessional by Robert Innes, narrated by Paul Woodson. Chapter 1. The village of Harmschapel was quiet as it slowly became enveloped in the orange glow of the evening sunset. Flocks of birds that had been tirelessly singing all throughout the day slowly became silenced, leaving nothing other than the odd starling competing from opposite sides of the surrounding fields. The gentle sound of 2 feet, tapping carelessly against a stone wall, did nothing to break the stillness. The panoramic view from this wall had always been Harrison's favourite part of the village. He was sat atop it, with his legs dangling over the side. He had sat on this wall since he was a child, sometimes when his parents had brought him into the village to do their shopping, or at other times when he had been a little bit older and had been allowed to come here on his own. As he had grown taller over the years, his feet had slowly got closer to the ground, but even today on his 23rd birthday, they weren't quite there. Deep down he hoped they never would reach, and that he would always be able to have his feet just hanging in the air. Harrison closed his eyes so that the sounds around him grew just that little bit louder. His muscles began to relax, and the intrusive thoughts in his mind started to slowly disintegrate. It had been a long day. Harrison hadn't told anybody about his birthday, as he had not wanted the reminder that he was in the village, on his own, with no real family or friends around him, on his one special day of the year. And while he didn't feel the need for anybody to know about it, the one thing he didn't want to feel today was sad and lonely, so he was content to just settle for general apathy. Unfortunately, one thing sitting on this wall had always done was clarify his feelings. The wall had helped him through quite a few of the toughest times of his life. When he was 10 and had smashed his mum's favourite plate while playing in the kitchen, he had ran out of the house and come here to help decide how to own up to it. When he was 16, he had stared out over the same fields in exactly the same place and come to terms with his sexuality, and then a week or so later had debated how he was going to tell his parents. What he couldn't have known then was that a few years later, he would be sat here again with the side of his stomach throbbing angrily as a result of his then-boyfriend Daniel hitting him for no good reason and trying to work out why. Sitting here helped things make sense. But right now, for the first time, he could feel himself fighting that familiar feeling of clarity as he came to the somewhat miserable conclusion that he did, in fact, feel incredibly sad and lonely. The sun was setting on his 23rd birthday, and for the first time in his life, nobody had said happy birthday to him. This was the first birthday that Harrison had spent on his own. A year ago today, neither of his parents had been in prison because at that time they hadn't worked together to murder his ex-boyfriend. Now that had all changed. And while Harrison had finally started to adjust to his new life, living alone with his goat Betty, who he had kept since childhood, today was tough. The thought of Betty suddenly reminded him that he needed to feed her, so he swung his legs up and over the wall and began his walk home. In a strange way, he almost felt annoyed at the wall for letting him down. It hadn't helped him with anything other than forcing him to embrace feelings that he had been trying to keep hidden all day. Doing an all-day shift at the shop he now worked at had helped somewhat, but now that was over, he was left with little to distract him. It wasn't long before Harrison found himself strolling past the police station, which meant he was only a few minutes away from his cottage. It was quiet, much like the rest of the village around him. The evening was drawing in quickly now, and the lights from the windows were orange and glowing gently. Harrison stopped and watched the building as the wild and completely foolish thought of him strolling in and asking if D.S. Blake Harte was on duty went through his head. Quite what he would do if the answer to that question were yes, Harrison had no idea. "Don't be stupid," he said to himself. He continued walking past the station, and as he was silently thanking sense for prevailing, he heard a voice he instantly recognized. "Harrison?" Harrison froze. It was Blake. Harrison frantically wondered how his hair was looking, felt grateful for the fact that he was wearing a coat that covered up his work uniform, took a deep breath, and turned around with a grin. "Oh, hi, Blake!" Blake was standing at the door to the police station, e-cig in his hand. He wandered across to Harrison with a genuine smile on his face, one that Harrison quickly realized was less manic than his own.
"How have you been?" Blake asked. "I haven't seen you about in a while."
"I'm doing okay."
"I'm sorry about that night at the pub," Blake said.
He sucked on his e-cig, which then began flashing intermittently.
"Bugger out of battery."
"Don't worry about it," Harrison replied. "Was your friend all right the next day?"
Blake grinned as he put the e-cig back into his pocket.
"No, she was ridiculously unwell. Still, the amount of cider she drank does that to a person. I didn't have a single shred of sympathy for her."
Harrison laughed, then put his hands deep into his pocket, desperately thinking of something else to say. His brain had gone completely blank. There was a few seconds' silence, which felt like an age.
"Well, I'd best get back," Blake said. "You take care."
He turned to walk back into the station. From out of nowhere, Harrison suddenly said,
"It's my birthday today."
Blake turned around, his eyebrows raised.
"Yeah? Well, happy birthday. Have you got much planned?"
The last thing Harrison wanted Blake to know was the truth about his lack of celebration for the day.
"Oh, you know," he shrugged. "The usual."
"Well," Blake smiled, "I really hope you enjoy it. Don't do anything I wouldn't do."
"Fat chance," Harrison thought to himself bitterly.
"I won't, promise," he said instead.
Harrison turned and walked off down the street towards his house, unable to stop himself smiling happily. If only one person was going to wish him a happy birthday today, he couldn't have been happier that it was Blake.
Chapter 2. Filled with sympathy, Blake watched as Harrison wandered off down the street. Throughout his time in the job, there had been few people he had dealt with who had had to go through such huge emotional upheaval as Harrison Baxter. He thought back to a couple of months ago and the night he had seen Harrison in the dog's tail. Blake's best friend, Sally Ann, a sergeant from his old position before he had moved to Harmschapel, had been visiting, and as soon as she had clapped eyes on Harrison, Sally had tried to set the two of them up. Up to that point, Blake had not considered Harrison in any other way than a mere segment of the case he had been working on. With all of that over, he had realized that Harrison was a really lovely person, certainly a million miles away from Blake's ex, Nathan, who he had discovered cheating on him with a woman and was the ultimate reason he had come to Harmschapel in the first place. But while Harrison and Blake had been getting to know each other, and the smallest possibility for a mutual attraction had begun, Sally had quickly brought an end to the proceedings. The last cider she had downed had been one too many, and she had projectile vomited all over the bar before she could get herself to somewhere more discreet. Blake had been forced to say goodnight to Harrison only to take Sally home, where she had promptly passed out on his living room floor, not rising again till the next morning. Ever since that night, Blake had found himself wondering what could have happened between him and Harrison, but the opportunity to find out very much seemed to have passed. Blake walked back towards the station entrance, cursing himself for not bringing his e-cig charger to work. The unsatisfying performance from his e-cig had left the need for nicotine clawing at him. He had been trying desperately to quit smoking over the past year, with limited success, often finding himself standing in a shop asking for a pack of his usual tobacco. As he re-entered the meeting room, things were much the same as when he had left them. PC Billy Mattison was sat opposite PC Minnie Patil, both tapping idly at their computers, something Blake suspected they had only started doing when they sensed he was on his way back into the room.
"So, go on, sir,"
Mattison said once Blake had settled down again.
"Did you download it?"
Blake sighed. "Yes, Matty, I downloaded it."
"And?"
"And I don't think it's for me."
"Oh, come on, sir,"
Patil grinned.
You don't know unless you try.
Blake rolled his eyes and pulled his mobile out of his pocket, loading up the dating app that the two of them had suggested to him when he had made the, he now realized, incredibly foolish move of mentioning that he was a bit bored of being single to them. Madison stood up and came behind Blake, looking at his phone as the app cheerfully sprung into life, as if it was convinced it was the answer to all of Blake's problems.
There's got to be somebody here you fancy, sir. What about this guy?
Blake stared at the profile of the man who had appeared on his phone. Admittedly, he was very good-looking, and a quick glance over his details revealed a few similar interests to Blake.
Yeah, all right, he's nice.
So, swipe right, Patil said.
Blake flicked his thumb to the right on the screen.
Okay, now what?
Well, if it doesn't say you've matched with him, sir, then he either hasn't come across your profile yet, or...
He glanced at Patil, who rolled her eyes.
Or, sir, it means there's plenty more fish in the sea.
Blake frowned and stared at his phone as a picture of another man appeared. He looked to be in his late 50s and clearly was hoping for his incredible personality to shine through rather than relying on his profile picture. Blake grimaced at Teddy Bear and hastily flicked left on his screen. As much as it made him cringe that he was getting dating advice from his two youngest officers, Blake had to admit that his love life of late had been completely non-existent. Clearly, the life of a detective sergeant wasn't seen as attractive as it had been before he had moved to Harmschapel. He continued on his swiping mission, flicking left and right on his phone, not once coming across the words, "It's a match," that Madison had promised him he saw on his phone all the time. But then a face appeared that stopped Blake in his tracks. Harrison Baxter smiled up at him from his phone screen, his blonde hair styled modestly and yet probably unintentionally perfectly. His gentle features gave Blake a warm feeling in the pit of his stomach. His thumb hovered over Harrison's face. He knew which way he wanted to swipe, but he sincerely doubted that his phone would give him the response he wanted. Blake wasn't even sure he knew what the response he wanted was. Instead, he pressed the button on the side of his phone and put it back in his pocket, shaking his head. The whole dating app thing was ridiculous to him anyway. If you wanted to meet somebody, what was wrong with going to a pub or a bar and actually coming across somebody face to face? Blake didn't consider himself to be much of a fantasist, but it seemed more romantic when asked where he had met the love of his life to reply that fate had brought them together over a crowded dance floor, rather than they had both happened to be online at the same time.
"See anybody you like, sir?"
Patil asked him over her computer screen.
"No, not really," Blake lied. "Maybe I'm just the best-looking gay man in Harmschapel. Who knows?"
Patil laughed.
"Maybe you are, sir."
At that moment, the doors to the meeting room flung open and Sergeant Michael Gardner stormed in. Blake glanced up at him as Gardner kicked his chair out from underneath his desk and threw himself down on it.
"Evening, Michael,"
Blake said cheerfully.
Gardner glared at Blake. "Someone at the front desk for you."
"Me? Who is it?"
"Well," Gardner replied brusquely, "not necessarily just for you. One of you two can go. I don't care. I've dealt with her the past 2 times she's been in, and frankly, I have better things to be getting on with."
A groan rippled its way through the office.
"Oh, please don't make me go and talk to her, please, sir," pleaded Madison, sinking down into his chair. "She hates me. She's hit me with her umbrella before. That's assault."
"Matty, she's 81. She couldn't assault you if she tried," Blake replied flatly.
"She's surprisingly fast for her age,"
Patil said, looking just as reluctant to go anywhere.
"Remember when those lads sprayed graffiti over her back fence? She properly ran after them. She actually ran. She's terrifying."
Blake rolled his eyes. All right, I'll go. But don't think I'm not making a note of this sudden willingness to throw your boss to the lions."
He stood up, waggling his pen at Madison, who looked positively relieved. When Blake arrived at the reception desk, he found Sergeant Mandy Darnwood looking furiously at the elderly woman standing in front of her. The second she saw Blake, Darnwood's expression changed drastically.
"Okay, there you go, Mrs. Atkins. D.S. Harte will deal with your complaint."
She pressed the notepad in which she had been scribbling into Blake's chest, grabbed her cigarettes from underneath the desk, and quickly left the office. Blake watched her make her frantic escape out the back door with his eyebrows raised, and then turned to the angry-looking woman behind the desk. She was glaring at Blake expectantly, her wrinkled mouth screwed up slightly. She narrowed her eyes at him, which made her entire face look not dissimilar to an old walnut.
"Well," Imelda Atkins snapped, "what are you going to do about the noise?"
"What noise?" Blake asked, eyeing the umbrella that she had firmly gripped in her hand.
"The noise coming from across the road from my house,"
Imelda exclaimed, looking at Blake as if she thought he was the most stupid man on earth.
"It's those bloody college students, booming music out at all hours of the day. Not that I'd call it music, just noise. I'm fed up with it."
Blake's eyes glazed over as Imelda continued ranting at him.
"And you know full well that this isn't the first time I've complained about this. As a matter of fact, this is the third time I've either had to come in or ring, and I've had enough. I want these people arrested. I know my rights as a citizen."
Blake sighed. "Mrs. Atkins, I can't arrest a group of teenagers for playing loud music, especially not at 6 o'clock in the evening."
"Well, what are you going to do?" snapped Imelda. "What are you for if it's not to keep the public safe and happy?"
"Right," Blake said as politely as he could muster. "I am due to finish very soon. I will go across to the house on my way home and tell them that they need to not play their music at an unreasonable volume."
"You mean order them?"
"Yes, yes," Blake replied, a little sharper than he had intended. "I will order them to keep the noise down, all right?" Imelda's lips somehow thinned even further.
We'll just see to it that you do."
She picked up her handbag from the reception desk and thrust it up her shoulder.
"I'm off to evensong at the church now. I trust when I get home it will be to peace and quiet."
"Yes, Mrs. Atkins," Blake grimaced. "I promise you that by tonight you won't be hearing a thing."
"Good,"
Imelda sniffed. She sauntered out of the station, putting her umbrella back into her handbag. Blake briefly wondered whether she had got it out purely as an intimidation technique.
"Is she gone?"
Darnwood was stood in the doorway to the office, the scent of cigarette smoke clinging to her. The smell triggered Blake's nicotine cravings again.
"Yes, give me a cigarette."
Darnwood narrowed her eyes.
"Aren't you supposed to have packed them in?"
"Yes, give me a cigarette."
Darnwood shook her head.
"You want to try chewing gum. My fella swears by them. It gives your mouth something to do. You'll thank me when the craving goes away."
Blake grimaced and rolled his eyes, walking out of the reception office and back into the meeting room. Mattison looked up from his computer screen as he stormed through the door.
"What did she want?"
Blake picked his jacket up off his chair and flung it over his shoulder grumpily.
"She wanted me to lock up a group of college students for playing music too loudly. Now I'm going home, unless there's any more pensioners you lot are too scared to face."
Mattison and Patil glanced at each other, amused.
"No, sir," said Mattison. "See you in the morning."
"She had her umbrella with her, then?"
Gardner asked wryly, not looking up from his computer screen. Blake's nicotine cravings scratched at him again as he grunted in reply and left them to it. It amazed him how quickly the hankering for a cigarette could diminish his mood. If he didn't get one soon, then the college kids he now had to visit on his way home probably would find themselves being locked up before the night was over. Admittedly, the music was quite loud. Blake was leaning against a wall opposite the house, listening to the heavy drum and bass exuding from it. He had picked up a pack of cigarettes from a shop on the outskirts of the village and was now smoking one, regretting every inhalation. He finished it and flicked it into the nearest drain, Conceding he had been a trifle optimistic when he had reduced the nicotine in his e-cig to 0 milligrams, and walked purposefully towards the house, knocking sharply on the door. After a moment or two, the door opened and Darrell Stewart's, a tall, lanky teenage boy, stood in front of him, clutching a can of beer in each hand.
"Hello, Darrell,"
Blake said, eyeing the beer and discreetly sniffing the air to check that there wasn't anything more interesting than beer being enjoyed at the party. Darrell's face dropped as he realized who Blake was.
"All right. I didn't realize you were old enough to be drinking. My invite to your 18th must have got lost in the post, unless it hasn't happened yet."
Darrell futilely tried to hide the beer behind his back.
I'm just holding them for someone."
"Oh, right."
Blake nodded, mildly amused.
"Someone that is 18, yeah?"
Darrell nodded.
"Where are your parents?" Blake asked.
Darrell seemed temporarily struck dumb.
"They're on holiday," he said at last. "I've only got a couple of people over. We're not doing anything that bad, I promise."
The loud sound of jeering and chatter emanated from inside the house. Blake raised an eyebrow.
"A couple of people? Or a couple of football teams?"
Darrell didn't reply, merely standing there looking incredibly awkward.
"Look, do me a favour and just turn down the music. I've had a complaint."
"Was it that miserable cow from across the road?"
Darrell asked moodily.
"It doesn't matter who it was from," Blake said, though he could hardly disagree with Darrell's sentiments about him, Elder. "Just turn it down, because if I have to come back here, it'll be with my official head on, and trust me, neither of us want that."
Darrell nodded and disappeared sheepishly behind the door. Blake turned and walked away from the house as the music was drastically lowered in volume. But then, no sooner had his ears registered the silence, another loud blaring noise rang out from across the village. A few moments later, an ambulance came tearing by, its blue lights flashing wildly and siren wailing. It sped around the corner and came to a stop next to the church, which was situated a few yards away from Darrell's house. Blake frowned and jogged across the road to see what was going on. As he approached the churchyard, he saw the paramedics jumping out of the ambulance and run into the church. A few moments later, a small throng of distressed people spilled out of the doors.
"What's going on?" Blake asked as he walked towards them.
"Oh, Detective Harte!"
cried one of the older women, grabbing his arm.
"It's Imelda, she..."
The church door flung open and two ambulance men bounded out, pulling a stretcher on top of which was Imelda Atkins, eyes closed, and a blanket wrapped around her. Blake stared in surprise at Imelda's lifeless body as she was hurried towards the ambulance.
"What's happened?"
Before anyone could answer, a small elderly man in cleric's clothing appeared in the church doorway. It was the Reverend Timothy Croydon. Blake, not being a regular visitor in a church, had only seen him at the odd village fete that he had frequented, but he had certainly never seen Timothy with such a grave expression on his face.
"Ladies and gentlemen, I know this has all come as a great shock to us all. Perhaps a small prayer from you all tonight would be the correct approach."
A ripple of murmured agreement passed through the small collective. Timothy looked sadly down at the ground for a few moments, then spotted Blake. For a moment he looked like he was unsure as to say anything at all, but then said so quietly that the others couldn't hear,
"Detective Harte, isn't it?"
"That's right. Is there anything I can do?"
Timothy hesitated and glanced around.
"Not here. Would you come inside for a few minutes?"
Blake nodded and passed respectively through the upset congregation to follow Timothy back into the church. The organ at the other end of the building began to play. The somber tune, which Blake vaguely recognized from some of the funerals he'd attended over the years, reverberated around the church as he wordlessly followed the vicar.
"Just through here,"
Timothy murmured, leading Blake underneath a set of stone arches, above which were some brilliant paned glass windows depicting a series of saints and angels in blues, reds, and yellows. Eventually, Blake followed Timothy into the vestry. It was rather cramped, with large wooden cupboards around it. Blake could see various coloured robes and cassocks hanging up, and in the far corner was a smaller cupboard that Timothy opened briefly to put away the Bible he was carrying. Inside was a silver goblet and a large bottle filled with a deep red liquid, presumably communion wine.
"How can I help?" Blake asked, when Timothy again appeared hesitant to say anything.
"Well, I must confess that I don't exactly know that you can," the old vicar said finally. "But the Lord works in mysterious ways, and when I saw you standing there, I wondered whether I was supposed to tell you."
"Tell me what?"
"Imelda. It would appear that she's had a heart attack. They rushed her away fairly quickly, so I pray that she can be revived, but I fear it may be too late."
He paused again, apparently unsure of what he was trying to say.
"Go on," Blake coaxed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.